game one was so sick. Oh, it was so sick. Oh my goodness. Oh, so cool. I am so hyped to see how this game two goes down. And I am particularly interested in the ban phase, because we saw very standard bans in game one. But now that we had some very one-sided matchups, one of the surprisingly non-standard bans was the absence of a ban of Camille. And TSM picked that up, and they ran a roughshod over Cloud9 with it. So I am very highly expecting some bans to change here, particularly that Camille ban, but also possibly a Caitlyn ban or an Iron ban, because the Caitlyn, sure, went off, did a lot of damage that game, got a lot of kills. Great. Great for Caitlyn. She had a good game. You know, great for Wild Turtle. But what really enabled that was the weird rotational plays that an Ivern was able to make that game for TSM. So maybe instead of seeing a ban on Caitlyn, even though Caitlyn did very well, we might actually see the Ivern ban and the Caitlyn left up to do her thing, because if that lane hadn't gotten the first blood, hadn't gotten the additional kills from the Ivern ganks, maybe that lane wouldn't have gone so poorly. You know, maybe bot lane could have been the surviving lane for C9 and their ticket back into the game if that hadn't happened. The Talia Weaver walls were really good. I don't expect much change in bans from TSM's side of things. I expect them to continue to do very standard bans. But without further ado, let's hop right in and see how these bans go. First ban coming out, LeBlanc. Again, very standard ban. Kennen is what's going to be banned from C9. So feeling like they couldn't play it very well, so much effect in that last game, they're just going to take it off the table so TSM doesn't pick it. Clearly, since Cloud9 picked Kennen in their first game, and let it be against a Camille, who is the notoriously strong top laner on this patch, they have a lot of respect for the power of a Kennen. So they ban him out. They go back to the more standard bans. Rumble of Fizz is coming out. Fizz probably in the top lane, though that could also be mid lane. And then the Camille. So look at how heavy these lanes are pinched in the top lane. 3 and 1. 4 total bans for the top lane, even arguably 2, because you see a lot of tank Fizz in top. You don't see Fizz that often, just generally. But when you do see him, you more often these days are seeing him back in the top lane rather than the mid. So 2 bans for mid, 4 bans for top. So what does this mean, right? This means you have to prioritize getting your top lane for TSM. Because if they don't first pick it, they're going to be 5th down, maybe arguably 6th down in priority. Because Cloud9 has 2 picks to get their top lane and something else secured. But at the same time, and mid lane isn't pinched that heavily, it's just Fizz and LeBlanc, so it's fine to not pick mid right now. But that being said, jungle has no bans, bot lane has no bans, support has no bans. Those are 3 lanes you want to pick your favorite super comfort OP champion of the patch. And TSM only has 1 pick to do it. So TSM, I would say, should probably pick top. That would alleviate Cloud9 from needing to pick top until this pick here, right before the second round of bans, so top lane doesn't get even more banned out. They do have to pick it in the first rotation, but they don't have to pick it in the very first round of picks for them. That means they could pick a jungler and a bot, you know, or a jungler and a support, or an AD and a support, you know, get their duo lane set up. And whatever's left over from that is what TSM should either, depending on what they pick, they should match to not count, open themselves up to counter picks. Or, like, if it was like an AD or in a jungler, they should match that so they don't get like target banned out in the secondary phase here. But let's see what they pick. 4 top laners, definite top laners banned away already. 3 of them. I just can't believe so many top lanes. That is a definite change from earlier. In the first game, we did not see that kind of focus. I mean, just look. Like, we did not see that level of focus on the top lane. So we're going to go with Lulu. They think Lulu is the priority here. And what they're doing is saying, okay, you go ahead and pick who you want. We'll still be able to secure a top laner before the next round of bans. So 5 and 6 isn't as important to us as saying we want the number one support this patch, which in our opinion is Lulu. So maybe Cloud9 waits to pick their answering support here and gets a top laner. So they get their favorite top laner of the remaining pool and a jungler, because junglers aren't as heavily counterable. Unless you pick like a Moomoo or something, but no one's doing that on this patch. So they pick Ashe, again declaring our most OP bot lane champion, in our opinion, on Cloud9 is Ashe. So we're going to lock her in, make sure that we get our pick of the litter here. Once they lock it in, they're probably thinking about what lane they want to pick next right now. So yeah, they do go for the jungler, and Graves has been notoriously the strongest jungler for a couple patches, including 7.6 we're on. I think this patch does include the slight nerf to his magic resist. But, you know, that's fine. So this does open up, since they have picked a support, this opens up the opportunity to get their support banned out if they want to lock in their top laner here before the next round of bans, which I would think you almost have to do. I would declare that this has to be a top lane pick, because if they can further target ban two more out and even pick their own, that's insane. Unless if TSM opts to not pick their top laner here to sort of challenge them, which again would make them super vulnerable to this being the top laner and then target banning with their two bans. I don't see any way that top laners aren't locked in here. I'd be very surprised. But this opens up the possibility for their support to get target banned out. And the answer could be either the jungler being their target ban or the AD being their target ban. So they're going to answer a pick in the jungle. They're saying Rengar is like our favorite second, you know, after Graves probably. And Rengar can make a lot of plays. Lulu certainly enables him quite heavily. I'm very surprised by this, you guys. I can't believe it. I can't believe it! So this is actually going to be a really interesting game top. And we'll get to that in a moment. Lulu helps Rengar because she can speed him up in his ultimate. She can give him a shield so when he goes super deep, he can survive. She can ult him so after he jumps in, he also can deliver CC through the knockup. And they lock in Syndra for Bjergsen. Syndra, you guys know how much I love Syndra. She's so strong. Bjergsen, this man right here, one of the most capable people on Syndra I've ever seen. It's definitely good to get Bjergsen his Syndra before it gets banned out in the secondary phase. But this really opens them up to get their top lane banned out a lot. I mean, again, theoretically we can go old school and have that be a top lane Lulu, but you just don't see that these days. Certainly not the current meta. So let's see. Let's see what they do. Are they going to pick the top lane and slam down? Well, effectively by picking their what's left top tier top laner and then throwing two target bans, Hanzo is going to be super banned out. Okay, Echo is somebody who can be flex top and mid. I would almost say that's for sure mid just because of how he plays into Syndra. There's between being able to stun her to get a little bit better control of how the fight's going and just being able to ult away when she ults you, I would almost guarantee that's going to be an Echo mid lane. But picking an Echo mid lane doesn't just give a good matchup in the mid lane. It also, since it can be flex top, is another indirect way to take out some of the top lane power.
But that leaves both of them vulnerable. Neither of them have their tops. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, arguably 5 people. Arguably 5.5 people with Echo taken out of the top lane. So this has become a game of chicken between these two teams. Is either side going to be brave enough to ban out more top laners? Or is Cloud9 going to ban out the remaining ADs to pressure Wild Turtle? And TSM going to ban out the remaining supports, having already secured theirs on both sides, to pressure Smoothie? Those are the two main ways this can go right now. Cloud9 says we're not afraid. They ban out Renekton. TSM says, okay, we're a little bit afraid of that. We're going to go ahead and ban out Karma. We're going to pressure Smoothie. Because rather than shooting both of us in the foot, this just hits you. So theoretically, it is smarter, but that's it really pushes the issue in top. And if you think you have the better top laner, you ban out top here. And that's what this is declaring. This ban is saying that we think Impact is stronger 1v1 versus Hauncer. It has a deeper champion pool than Hauncer. Just really confident. And what do we see? So they only do that the one ban of Renekton, and I'm pretty sure Cloud9 banned Renekton in the previous game as well. So it is just a power ban in their mindset. But also, it might not be something that Impact is particularly proficient at, which could be another reason they banned it out, even though it sort of was shooting them both in the foot. And that allowed TSM to get two target bans onto Smoothie, whereas the virus could only return one target ban onto Wild Turtle. But they do get to get the first pick of the last round here on C9. So are they going to pick the support just to not reveal what their top laner is? No, of course not. They're going to pick the top laner. Make sure they get what they think is the remaining top tier top laner of Nautilus. I'm inclined to agree. I like the Nautilus. And we're going to see Lucian picked up. Pretty standard pick. I would be surprised if they change that. Probably just deciding what they want to pick into a Nautilus from what's left top. I'm trying to think of what matchups I have trouble with as Nautilus. Okay, they're going to swap over. They're going to pick the Gragas instead. I mean, they're still going to pick Lucian here. I would be surprised if they don't pick Lucian. There are some other champions that you could pick, like Kog'Maw. And since they have the Lulu, it is possible that they could go Kog'Maw, but they don't have much additional protection. So, yeah, Lucian I'm not surprised to see. Gragas, definitely in one of the upper tiers as far as top laners are concerned. Once we've banned out all these guys, probably is the optimal pick and picked away Nautilus. And what does that leave? That leaves the support. Couple of target bans and the pick away. So certainly only 3 down, so not like it's super target banned out for Smoothie. He still gets Zyra, who brings a lot of CC, brings a lot of mixed damage. Probably going to go more utilities out of this game, because Jensen's going to bring enough consistent damage, bring enough consistent magical damage, and Nautilus has ambient magical damage to supplement that already. So Smoothie is probably going to go like full utility Zyra, and just try and bring the CC from the root, try and use the plants to zone, so probably getting some additional cooldown reduction is a priority for him, to get more plants out more quickly, to keep summoning them out of their seeds more quickly, and using his ultimate to zone. This is a nasty lane, Zyra and Ashe, because Ashe can ult you, and then right as that ultimate is winding off, Zyra can root you, and the whole time you're in her plants, then she can ult right as the root is ending to knock you up, and all the plants that you've been in the whole time now get a huge attack speed buff. So Zyra will do a lot of damage in that lane if they can get those abilities to work properly together. So let's jump right into it. Let's see the lanes. Yes, we're all excited. Jump forward a little bit. Okay, so it's not going to be a 5-point start from TSM. They're going to look for an invade here. They did have one person split up top. This still looks like a 5-point start. They haven't seen anyone else yet. And Echo not seeing somebody mid is a little suspicious, but that's not super unusual.
Even when you just see the one person confidently moving forward, you kind of have
to... And now that Gragas is there, it could mislead them slightly. They don't really see Gragas yet, though.
They don't want to get immediately shoved in early. You do expect that bottom lane stack, or at least...
And the TSM chance in the background. Wulu took a better forward position against Zyra, which is important because Zyra wants to sit in bot lane right now and start summoning the plants from her passive.
Top lane wards were actually placed by C9, even with the threat of a stack of
her. And Lulu wants to crush them if possible to get better control of that initial lane. Looks like we're going to have what has become the standard start for junglers in LCS, where they start the Raptors. And the mid laner's Leash. Ash throws down a ward to see if there's any cheeky invade coming.
So not really looking for the edge there as much as they are looking for power around the team fights. That's where they're expecting to be from the side.
Good trades from Lulu. She does have Thunder Lords. So she will be able to get a lot of damage out in this lane and answer Zyra pretty effectively. Both of them started the Spell Thief's edge. Again, that's why you do the Raptors, get the early level 2, so you can clear the last one pretty easily.
I do believe that they're aware of where he's going to be starting, you can certainly expect it. Being that ranged jungler, you can essentially clear wherever you want, though, and stay very helpful.
Not too much. Actually, fairly even trades until this Piercing Light came out and hit Sneaky. This was actually going to bend C9's favor. And then they get the double shot off, too. Do get some good return damage on the Wild Turtle, so that comes out being more equal than it should in the end.
After the first blood happened to contract on the big last game, he's going to be more conservative.
Let's take the red and move over to his right-hand side of the jungle. Looks like he might have actually picked straight towards the blue buff, so if he can make a stop by the blue.
He's going to run straight down here, because see how pushed up they are right now? He wants to get this blue buff as quickly as possible and then go gank with his level 3. If he can get the level 3 gank off using the blast cone over and then come in from behind, that could very easily be a kill in the bot lane to start things off.
Bjergsen
setting up some vision on the bottom side, assuming that Graves started the standard start of the Raptors to the red and is now working his way over bottom. She's warming up. This is more defensively for her lane to see if he's going to come through the river there to look for a gank. Nice deep ward from Nautilus there. Nice deny of the blast cone. That means not only are they going to know when Rengar's on topside and know that he's probably headed there because he hasn't taken blue yet, but also, when he does come topside, if he ever looks for a gank, he's not going to be able to use the blast cone to get over. Impact is already on super surviving everything Nautilus. So, and there's not that much kill pressure from a Gragas. The push started to go back out. They probably communicated as well that there was a ward down here. Did the C9 bot lane. So Contrax instead decides to go back to Wolves. Maybe back after that because it's a long walk over to Krugs. Or he clears Gromp, then Wolves. He might come back bot. No, it looks like he's actually going to go over to Gromp. And they see Svenskeren here. So it could be that in trying to answer, there could be a gank from Rengar coming up. Graves is going to rotate over to take these Krugs, and then he'll go wait and try brush. So when Rengar comes in for the gank, they can spring a counter gank. Depending on if they see Rengar go for the gank or not. Which he's still in vision, and he doesn't know that he's on a ward right now. So they actually wrap around and are going to look for a gank mid instead. They spot the ward, so they clear that out. And now they're going to go fight over Scuttle, both of them. Graves sees Rengar coming, so they just throw down the ward. And now they're both on their way up to top to make this happen. So that's going to be a fight top lane. But right now, let's look at this fight bot lane. Pretty equal start so far, because Sneaky was getting good harass on a wild turtle. Both of the minion lines are receiving the call for help. There's slightly more for C9. But Zyra's very squishy, and Biofrost hasn't had any of the damage returned onto his Lulu yet. Whereas all the damage has been put on Zyra. So it's kind of the same for Wild Turtle's Lucian. But Lulu is not something to be trifled with early on in the game. She does a lot of damage if she goes for the Spell Thieves. So Smoothie actually has to be really careful to not die here. Wild Turtle probably can't get back into the thick of things, but that means that Sneaky has to start walking this way. Smoothie has to immediately retreat out. And Biofrost, being the more aggressively positioned one, can go forward. While Smoothie is retreating, he can swap targets over to Sneaky, who's going to be bringing himself in range to deprioritize Smoothie, if Smoothie doesn't flash, which we already know he's going to. And that whole time, the damage that Biofrost, again, isn't to be trifled with, is going to be put onto Sneaky, which is going to make it more easy for Wild Turtle to come back in and join the battle onto Sneaky, who will now be in a 2v1. But we see the Ignite coming out from Biofrost and the flash forward on Svenskeren to try and finish off Smoothie. The heal came out from Sneaky, so Smoothie's likely to survive this, even if the double shot comes out, though it will be close. Maybe if Biofrost flashes as well, and then gets one more auto, or definitely a Glitter Lance would finish it, but it gets one more auto onto Smoothie, maybe the picks is enough to finish him off. But Smoothie has an exhaust and flash still, so Smoothie will probably be able to live, which means, look at the position. Sure, it's a 2v1, but Wild Turtle is the one that's more forward. So all of the damage that Ash is going to be throwing out from her W is going to hit Wild Turtle. There's not a whole bunch of minions here to defend Wild Turtle. Their line is over here, and they are all in the middle of the call for help for Cloud9's minions. So this looks very bad right now. But as long as Smoothie can make it out, and Biofrost was a little late on the flash there to try and get the last auto, like we were saying, if he had been just a little bit quicker, Smoothie probably would be dead right now. Smoothie flashes in time, so Sneaky can turn and focus Lucian a little bit, but there's so much damage coming out from Lulu. So much damage. It's just too much. You can't overcome it, even with that favorable positioning. It's just too much. It's not like a Braum or a Thresh. It's too much. So, Sneaky has to flash as well. Not much happens because of top. Or at top, rather. Rengar's was waiting for a kill, and then he decides to just go for the minions. Yeah, with the answer flash, that's it. It actually goes on to Jensen, which is really nice, because now Jensen has a blue, right? A fresh blue buff. That's gonna make Syndra's life hell. So Syndra took cleanse this game, just for the stun from Jensen's Echo. But like, remember, the reason Svenskeren started pathing up this way was because he was looking for that blast cone, but it was already down. So he just got toasted there. And this is a little greedy going for this when Bjergsen isn't in lane yet. Sure, Jensen backed, but like they're saying, he has his teleport. So he teleports forward. Probably didn't need to flash here. because Jensen was coming, but good secure matches, both flashes for both sides. I'm sure this is a combat summoner advantage, air quotes, for Bjergsen. This is a situational combat summoner. This is a situational that could be considered a combat summoner. It's basically equal still mid lane. Aside from the blue buff, which tips it massively in Jensen's favor. Because remember, it's one thing to get a kill that you haven't cashed in yet, but like, he's ahead in levels and has a blue buff. So that's just huge trade advantage for him. Actually comes out a little bit behind in the health because Jensen is chewing through those biscuits. But he's got a corrupting potion with the dark seal to buff up the heal from it. Jensen's going to be just fine on his health. And what's really to be paid attention, why I said it was favorable, is because the mana pool. Bjergsen's running out of mana. Jensen certainly is not. A D spot, Svenskeren. Good shot there from Sneaky.
Also just gives you so much extra control early on in the game. That was an unwarded jungle that they just gained total knowledge of.
Okay. Auto out of play in the bottom lane, but does not use the blast cone to maybe set up a dive. Sneaky not six just yet, so a little trickier to set up for some sort of game.
Yeah, that level six for the C9 bot lane is going to be incredibly important.
Not much happening right now. I mean, you're starting to see the wards. The control is far in favor of C9 right now. They're already, and they've got more, like, through contracts being here. They've got a lot of presence right now in the jungle. Oh, unfortunately, he reveals himself because he was going to get the red. So, Scaring does have the level advantage, so seeing that, he pops the ultimate. And the rotation, okay, so we saw, right? We saw over here that it's Graves and Echo. But judging from this, you can tell that Zyra made it over. And Sneaky on Ashe wasn't rotating exactly with Zyra. So these two broke the two apart and got to all in Sneaky. And that's why you have to rotate together. And now we see, sure, Zyra was able to help contracts make it out of there with the secured red buff. But Sneaky's almost dead. It's only because neither of them have flash and heal for the speed buff isn't up either that Sneaky barely makes it out with his life. Probably worth it to get the red buff, but the cost of that is that they're going to lose control of this lane. They're going to be able to push it in and deny a lot of farm and experience from Sneaky. And Svenskeren didn't get a kill off his first ultimate, which does make a lot of difference. Trying to answer by aggroing the blue. Not going to happen. Beautiful ultimate from Hanser. Oh my god, he killed him. I can't believe it. Wow. What? Did you? Oh my god, that's insane. I mean, there's not much to really show about that again other than that was just a beautiful ultimate from Gragas to ult him back into the turret right as the minions died. Great job by Svenskeren to go into the leap range to finish him off, because that Zyra ultimate wasn't going to be enough. Beautiful. And just like that, TSM are back in this game. After losing that control, it just feels like disparaging. I mean, no, he has ultimate. He's fine. Oh! Oh, he missed! Oh, no! Okay, here's why he didn't use it, right? Let's go back. So he goes forward, right, to make sure that the second shot of his timewinder hits Bjergsen, Great. And now he's walking. He has the shield on him from the zone. He's auto-attacking Bjergsen. He has the ultimate right now to jump back. He thinks one more auto will kill Bjergsen. Let me flash to match him because Bjergsen just flashed. Flash, get the last auto. But then it doesn't kill him. So he's like, you know, I really want to kill him. Let me just hang out and get one more auto attack. I think I can survive this last turret shot. Let me get one more auto on him, and then I can ult. Or he thought my attack speed was quick enough to where I could sneak an auto in right as the turret shot was hitting me, and then I can hit ult immediately after the auto goes off, and then I become invulnerable while I'm ulting back to this position here. But he just, it was a slight miscalculation on how much damage he would take, or it was a slight miscalculation on how quickly he would reset his auto. And look at that, he saw the facepalm. Literal facepalm from Jensen there. Like, oh man, that's so unfortunate. It was to a Syndra too. Oh my goodness. Oh dear. Oh no. This is not looking good for Cloudman right now. Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
Was not up, and Jensen, you could see, was distraught there on the player cams.
Yeah, he... You do not want to give up a kill like that to a Syndra as Echo, because you need to like make use out of that exact kind of play. Look at this. So he doesn't get the stun, but he gets the shield, right? So he thinks he's going to be fine. And that maybe thinks it gives the illusion of him tanking up more damage than he thought.
And then he didn't estimate that amount of damage to come through from the turret, which had been hitting him for quite some time, and that one hurts.
Yeah, a bit of a face bomb there. Well, Turtle actually in trouble. Lulu ultimate burnt out by Bio. Going to try and keep him safe.
That's really good positioning from Wild Turtle to just walk through the minions. So even if the cloning doesn't finish him off, it doesn't matter because he's going to get more of the cloning onto Sneaky. And he cancels. I'm not sure if it timed out or he canceled the last bit because Sneaky was going to be able to walk to dodge it to get the double shot off. And that forces a flash. So close. Beautiful ult again from Hanser to knock him back into ult range for Rengar. They can juggle the aggro easily. Didn't even need to. And here's the thing. We saw previously, let's go back, right? Before this even happens. Remember, in that last engagement, they blew every summoner spell. And they were that low to where I didn't even like cross their health bars by zoning out their summoner spells. Wild Turtle has flash still, right? And Wild Turtle is the primary damage source. It's not like Zyra where she also brings about as much damage as Ashe does right now. Lucian is the primary damage source for TSM. So him being able to flash forward means that they get to bring their primary damage source into a fight. Trying to pause this. So right here, as soon as they say, okay, we'll trade with you, they say, the reason they're saying this is because their minions are already here. TSMs are still just slightly out of frame. But Wild Turtle says, okay, if I can actually land this piercing light and chunk you back down, because they're out of regen now, they use the last of their regen, if I can get this piercing light and the follow-up double shot off on Sneaky, that's going to be a good chunk of his health. And then I can just flash in and auto him. I don't even really need to do much else. Like, if I get one other double shot off, that's almost certainly a kill. Lulu seeing that, just shields him up. I don't think he's speeding him up. But that's, like, what are you going to do? You're going to try and summon your plants. You're going to try and throw down the ultimate to zone them out as much as possible. But again, Lucian just flashed. There's nothing else you can do. And that's a double kill. Oh my god, this has got to be just wrecking C9's mindset right now.
Turtle goes aggressive with it, flashing over the Zyra ultimate. While Rengar is in the top lane, that's not normal when you expect him to go aggressive. Contracts trying to...
All the TSM chants from the crowd.
Contract already low. There's
Contract's trying to make a play here, knowing that he has both Echo and Impact's Nautilus coming in with him. So he's willing to take that huge chunk of damage because he knows they have to keep retreating. Even though if they turn on him, they could kill him. Like, it's a 3v1, so these two would get a double kill. So they have to keep running. So he's able to go this far forward. Great job having Jensen lead the charge here, because remember, because he didn't use it earlier, he still has his ultimate backup, so he can be the first one to tank this turret. He can ult back to drop aggro on the Nautilus, who can tank it up very easily because he's full health and a Nautilus. And then Jensen can continue to do a whole bunch of damage before Impact has to back away. He even gets the shield too, so he can tank an additional turret shot. Now he drops the aggro. Don't quite get the kill yet! Oh my god! No! Oh my god! Everything's going wrong for Cloud9! Oh no! Those poor bastards! Oh my goodness! This is so sick! TSM, what are you doing? That's insane! Is that legal? Are you allowed to do this? Oh my goodness! Oh man! What do you say about a game like this, man? Holy smokes. Almost like 3.5k lead right now. 11 minutes in. 8-1. There goes the first brick. Now it's like a 4k lead. Oh, 4.5k lead. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Oh. I mean, top lane has a safe freeze right now for the Nautilus. Yeah. Think about that too. That's a really good point. So aside from the missed skill shots from contracts, I mean, here's the psychological effect of the mid lane death happening right now. Contract or Jensen takes that turret shot. He could arguably take one more if he didn't take any damage, but he should at least wait until that turret shot is about to hit him before ulting. He doesn't, which resets the turret a lot quicker. So Impact is going to take a turret shot about half a travel distance, like, I don't know, three Teemos, two Teemos, sooner than he should. And that is exactly the difference here. If Impact just had a little bit more time, maybe he made it out of there, maybe he got a little bit closer and got damage in. I don't know, though. He was even rooted. What do you do? He got rooted by the ball. It wasn't just slow, it was rooted. What do you even do? You're toasted. Man. What do you do? Oh, my goodness. TSM, sickening. So disgusting. So ill. And he goes clear out the pink ward. Good look for a fight here. They have the numbers here. Oh my god! Oh my god, do you see? He's in the blind. This means he can't see anything. In the Graves blind, TSM's Battlefrost was on comms telling him, okay, Ash is ulting, walk forward towards Graves. He did go this way. Okay, you cleared it, now just start walking out. Walk out. And like that, utter faith, that is the play of a bot lane that has complete faith in each other. Complete faith in each other. Because, again, look at this.
It's ridiculous. Like, this game is getting more out of control than...
He doesn't see this. They don't have vision right here. TSM doesn't. Right? So this asphalt that's coming out, he doesn't see it. It's only when it briefly passes through this brush. And, like, it briefly pokes out here before the smoke goes off. Oh, man. It's got to be some of that communication coming from Biofrost telling him, I don't see them yet. You got to be aggressive. I don't know, man. That's just good positioning, too. And look at that, they got the kill on Contracts. Balafrost is going to go down, but it's a 2v3, right? Which means elsewhere on the map, stuff like this is happening. There goes Jensen. Now, overall, it's a 2-for-1. I guess if you're C9, you'll take that. Oh, but man, look at these numbers. Every lane is fed now. It's not just like last game where like a bot lane got super far ahead. Every lane is crushing. What do you do? What do you do? Anyways, this is going to be another turret down. It's going to be mid-outer going down. That's the most critical early game turret. Gone. And they're all rotating bottom now to take that final outer turret that has no health. Like, Smoothie might die here. He's using the blast cone, but there's Syndra. And now Syndra's going to get their blue.
I mean, C9 is honestly just looking mentally destroyed right now. It feels like nothing can go right for them.
Oh, man. This is utter devastation. What do you do with your C9? After that, there was a huge crushing loss in game one. And now this is how you open game two. What does that do to your mentality, man? Oh, so close. And beautiful fade back to position for... Look at that, one more time. You saw Lucian's ult? He's going right onto Kotrax. He dashes back to create more distance, right? But then he walks back forward to keep it in range. He jukes both down and back up to cover if Kotrax was starting to leave. Doesn't quite see him yet though. He's got the blind issue. But like he's weaving in and out of it. So he doesn't see Kotrax yet. So that means he's going this way. Which means he can weave back up like he did. And you'll notice he still is weaving up, even if it didn't finish him yet. He's got the cover, and it's rotating the last shots of the coin up to get a little bit of damage up here. He can't quite finish him, or he can't quite get far enough up to hit all of the finish of the ultimate onto Smoothie or Sneaky. So he walks back down, and he lets it run out, just in case he missed something and didn't get contracts, but then he sees it displayed, so he's got it. Beautiful play by Lucian there. Wild Turtle is insane. The Turtle, sickest Turtle, most ill Turtle NA. Confirmed. It's yet to be decided if he's the best bot laner NA. But he is the sickest Turtle NA. We know that for certain. Good bait here. Oh, the Nautilus. See, and this is what I'm saying. I think they've got to just be mentally destroyed. Nautilus Q minion there. There's no reason you hook this minion. Super clear. Sure, it walked a little bit in your way. Oh, man, this is devastating. Sure, it walked a little bit in his way, but you just walked down just in case. And you walk down to secure, even if it didn't start to walk down, it still could have hit on it, because the hitbox on Nautilus's hook is pretty generous. Oh, man. And then the ult came out, because he hadn't ulted yet.
You send three people at Haunter, impact dredgelines a minion after ulting him, and then Sven Skaren comes in for the counter kill. It just keeps going well for TSM.
It keeps going wrong for Cloud9.
I'm telling you, man, this is the mental fatigue of the highest pressure game of the season so far, the finals for the spring split. In that first game, and now what is looking like a landslide, C9 is just losing control of this. They've lost their equanimity, right? They've lost control of their composure here. And look at that. Great, great stuff. Bjergsen took the cleanse, the stun from the Jensen's Echo, the stun from the Ash's ultimate, the root from the Zyra, none of it matters. He does find the right target, doesn't blow it on Jensen, who could ult away, gets it on the Ash, and now they get this turret for free. That's another turret down. This, you guys, this game is just looking like it's over. I don't know what to tell you. I don't know what to tell you. I'm sorry. Congratulations, TSM fans. But I don't know what to tell you. This one is going to be hard. This is going to be a tough one. 10K gold lead. This is going to be tough to come back from. The only thing was like C9 versus me and like my friends. They can come back from this. Not against TSM. TSM is not going to give breathing. Look at that. They even hit contracts with that just to give themselves a super safe back so they can farm a little bit on the way. Insanity.
Yeah, but these types of things I think really show the pressure and the way different players and teams respond to it. TSM are the
great pickup on the Dragon on their way out.
This team has been in stressful world situations before, whereas the last time Cloud9 was on the stage, they did have some problems then, because you see that 7,000 gold lead the TSM has, 3,000 gold higher than the regular season. That doesn't happen without some level of tilt happening from your opponent.
Good jukes there from Jensen. A really good calm play by Rengar to stay up. That way, when Jensen did his sort of like the, I don't know what it's called off the top of my head, but the tumble, and then he like blinks to you to get the auto, he could flash. It's good to not be walking towards him, because then he can like come at you from an angle, hit you on this side, and flash even further. This way, you had to hit him on this side, walk a little bit, then flash. And that gives Sun Scaring time to keep walking forward. Unfortunately, he doesn't have the ultimate available anymore. But Jensen did burn all of his utility and his flash and his dash. And Sven Skaren still had flash, so he could flash to the brush. Sven Skaren, or Jensen, only too late realized that that bush could be a problem if he had flash, right? Because look, he had to walk and take all of that damage. It was about, like, that much damage just to get on this side of Sven Skaren, because Sven Skaren stayed positioning on this corner of him. And since he had to flash away from Sven Skaren at an angle, well, what else is this way? That brush, right? So as we go forward, he's running straight. He's not even running towards the brush. And he starts winding away from it very quickly. But because he had to flash at this angle, it brought him so much farther this way that he can't escape this brush. And good call by Sven Skaren just to flash immediately, not to even risk it. A disgusting play! Unbelievable! Utter chaos and destruction. Oh, and an almost 10k gold lead right now. 5 turrets to 0. It's a good hook. Hey, hold on, let me put down my water. So they don't know that Graves and Zyra are here. Graves brings a lot of follow-up burst damage. Zyra also brings follow-up burst damage, but also creates chain CC. So all they need to do is get the Nautilus hook off of impact. If they can do that, they should be able to chain CC and it would be fine. It doesn't look like... I think Nautilus's ultimate is up. It's kind of hard to tell with the graphic. So even if it's not, he should be able to hook and then root, and then Zyra can root and ult, and that should be enough chain CC to get him dead. Seeing this positioning, walking like this, should make these two a little wary of why Impact thinks he can just walk up to them for free with no turret security, right? So they should play a little defensively here. It's going for that last hit right there. A little bit of greed for the minion that Wild Turtle gets punished for. He does flash this. And it's the last bit of shielding from the shield from Pix and the ultimate from Lulu that keeps him alive. 100% should have died there. If it wasn't a game with this kind of score, that's 100% dead Lucian. Probably Lulu would go down with him. But they just have... Oh my god, he got him with the Ash Arrow! Oh my god, alright, good. Good, they deserved that. Unfortunately, Sneaky's gonna go down and answer a kill. And they do get the Lulu. Now this is actually pretty sloppy from TSM to let this happen. They have such a strong lead, they shouldn't be taking like indecisive skirmishes like this. They are going to turn it into a 2-4-4, but oh, he's got to hit the stun here. Okay, they got him for sure. It's actually only going to be a 3-for-2. That's horrible. When you've got this much of a lead, you shouldn't be trading anywhere near 3-for-2. You should be getting 3-for-nothing, 4-for-1. You know, that's so sloppy to have traded like that. Let's keep an eye on Ash during this. Right? When does he use it? Right there. Boom. And he started to step away too, and he came back. The jitters, man. Look at this. He's walking a little bit forward, and he turns back at the last second. Like, why that last little turn back? Probably still doesn't matter. But man, the jitter's coming out a little bit. TSM getting a little bit ahead of themselves, thinking they got this game already wrapped up. They got the whole series. They got the finals. This is how you throw this, man. They just got to play it by the numbers. They still have a disgusting lead. It's basically 10K gold still. Yeah, and look at that. They can go in on a tank and just melt them. Just calm play like that. They're all grouped together. Basically all grouped. I mean, they have the top laner split pushing. But, like, they should be able to handle themselves plenty right now. Because when you have a lead like that, if you group it together, like, that is so much of the lead present that it takes some hugely significant engage, like maybe this and catch, to make it happen. But you have a Lulu. She has the shield, she has the ultimate. And that gives Bjergsen plenty of time to get a lot of damage on here, and he takes down Sneaky with the help of Wild Turtle. Wild Turtle actually didn't even help. Just colon styling points. And now Hansard rotated up because the fight broke out. So now you got a full healthy tank who's like really ahead. He's not even gotten his second part of an item completed right there. Blade of the Rune King, you normally want to go Hurricane next. He is just so free inhibitor. They rotate mid. Trying to get as much damage down before this as they can to disincentivize it, and they actually do push him away. That's top inhibitor down. You know what that gives them? Absolute control of this top side. Right? Because they don't have this turret anymore. C9 doesn't. So this entire chunk of the map is controlled. Right? And with the minions pushing back, it's honestly more like this. Everything outside of this area is controlled by TSM right now. So whether they want to get the Baron, do a very early Baron rush, they want to make sure they secure the next Infernal Drake. It's all TSM's. All they do is hang out and look for picks. And they've got some deep wards presence already. So they have teleport flanks being set up. If you're actually in a close game, because there's been situations here. 12,000 gold lead. Insane. They just gotta play it by the numbers. As long as they don't get so cocky they start doing just whatever they feel like. Yeah, and it only takes a support to shove away the enemy top laner. Don't go crazy and all in them, because you're not exactly sure where they are in their rotation. But shove them back, you know? Keep that pressure, set it up, so that Gragas can come in here, escort the pressure right to the turret. This has a super minion in it, so this blue side wave is going to shove really hard in, and the rest of your team is mid. Beautiful. Set up the pressure, execute it by the numbers. Okay, we got impact now. Reaper play top lane. Oh, there you go, top lane.
Let me tell you, oh, never mind.
Yushin can run in. Poling doesn't get the kill, but knocks out Jensen, so Heavy has to go back to base, which means that this pressure that Gragas created before he came mid is going to mean that these minions will get there delayed. So after they take this turret, if Jensen is healed and is coming back and they feel they can't get this inhibitor, they can just rotate down, and then these minions will probably still be here at the bottom turret tanking it, so they can get damage onto the bottom inhibitor turret. Yep, and there it goes. Since he has to answer, Svenskeren pushing in the top lane. Since all five of them were grouped, Svenskeren split off and rotated to the top side to escort in the super minions. So that way this pressure here has to be answered. And then he can ult as soon as the answer from Jensen is coming, so that he's free to, one, say, hey, you need to get the fuck away from me because I'm Rengar and I just ulted. But two, he can just mosey his way down here to the team, not engaging unless they present him with a mistake, an opportunity for a pick. Just mosey on down, hang out. The threat of the Rengar ultimate is enough to zone them away from this inhibitor to where they secure this inhibitor for free, and then they all rotate down to this bottom lane, which is already bringing its pressure because the wave is coming behind it. And look at that, that's exactly what he does. Just hanging out, just zoning them away. Finally pops it to get the last hits on it. Now this is a very greedy way to path here, trying to path directly to it. And Impact again almost punishes. There's no reason you should be doing this. The rest of the team's rotating the safe way. Just take the extra couple steps to rotate with them. This is how you throw. They're fine. You can just dash right over. Not a big deal. But that's the cockiness. If they were against somebody like an SKT, stuff like that, Impact would have hit that hook if he was on SKT, you know? Beautiful. That's immediately 100-0. Probably can melt through the Impact. Yep. Might even be able to get the dive here because they have minions with them. Not quite. Jensen almost gets the kill on the way out. Actually does. Svenskeren winds up going down. But it's too little too late. Good sidestep on the stun there. But again, they're all on here. Like two inhibitors down. Third inhibitor is about to die. Only one coming up is Smoothie. It's just not enough. Jerkson still on cleanse. They do get the kill on him, but that's just too much pressure. Oh my goodness! Oh my goodness! Incredible! TSM is smashing them! Oh my god, you guys! I was not expecting it to be so one-sided! Holy smokes! What if this is a 3-0? I don't know. I thought this was going to go 5 games. Maybe it's just uploaded that way for the allure. I cannot imagine with these one-sided of games that C9 can come back. You know, maybe they pick up one win. I just don't see a way they can get a complete 3-0 reverse sweep. It's one thing if they needed a reverse sweep when the first two games were really close and TSM like just eked it out, right? That's all that's happening here. TSM is annihilating them. And when you get annihilated that hard, you're going to be playing from such a mental disadvantage. Like your mindset is going to be tested really hard. And at best, they're coming in as good as they came in game one, in which they got crushed. What are you going to do? What is there to do? Oh, I don't know, but we're going to find out. We're going on a break. We're going to come back. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness, everyone. I can't believe it. We're going on a brief break. We're going to find out what happens In the next clip, we're coming up though. On a break. On a break. Oh man, I need to get some water.